Well, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming to today's Dean's Lecture. And the weather is beautiful outside, and it's going to stay that way until through the reception. So it's so good to see so many of you here. And it's always a pleasure to celebrate the promotion of somebody to the rank of professor. As I always say, it's a decision that's not made by me or the A&P committee or even the chairs. It's really made by peers around the world who write in support of a person's promotion. And so it's difficult to get on the faculty here. It's an incredibly high bar to be promoted. So we're here to celebrate Andy Pekosz's promotion to professor. I remember when I first met Andy, and Diane Griffin was chair of MMI, and we were doing a symposium on influenza. And so Diane was planning the symposium, and the woman who was head of development at that time, Sylvia Eggleston Ware, came after meeting with Diane, came to me, and she was enraged. She was just enraged, and she said, "Do you realize we don't have a molecular virologist who does influenza at this school?" So it's always fun when development people come and say things like that, and so we decided, well, we needed to get one, and that we went out to lunch to meet. I was new as dean, and I was meeting donors, and we had a donor who we had lunch with, and who was peppering me with questions. Just peppering, like I couldn't eat. He was asking so many questions, and I brought this up that we didn't have somebody who did influenza virology. And when I got back to the office, he called and said, "You really need somebody," and that was the gift that allowed us to recruit Andy. And so it's a gift that has kept on giving for us over these years. So now's the part where I introduce the speaker and to people who know him far better than I do. But I have traveled with Andy, and I've always been impressed by his commitment to science and I can remember emailing him about 3:30 or 4 o'clock in the morning. I was in some other time zone, and he emailed right back. And I said, "Are you in another time zone?" He says, "No, I'm in the lab. The viruses needed to be fed, so I'm here." So, and his fascination with viruses started as an undergrad at Rutgers when he was using yeast killer virus and real virus, and that sparked his ongoing fascination with virus. And he calls them the master manipulators of cellular processes. And also, they cause disease. And so he got his PhD in virology at the University of Pennsylvania. And then he worked there with Neil Nathanson, who had been here for many years, and with Francisco Gonzalez-Garano on mosquito-transmitted bunyaviruses, and decided that this was going to be his career. For his postdoc, he joined the laboratory of Robert Lamb at Northwestern, where he studied the molecular and cell biology of influenza C virus infection before initiating a line of research focused on influenza A. And then for 7 years, he was assistant professor at Washington University in St. Louis School of Medicine in the Department of Molecular Microbiology and Immunology, where he continued to work on influenza A, in addition to working on several other respiratory pathogens, including hantavirus and SARS. During this time, he established primary differentiated respiratory epithelial cell cultures, which you probably all know about this. When I first learned about it, I thought it was incredibly innovative. So looking at for models of infection, biopsying the nasal epithelia and then growing those cells in culture and using them as a model. So in 2008 was when Diane recruited him to our school, and he came as an associate professor and has continued to study influenza as well as a number of other pathogens. So in 2015, he was promoted to professor, and just because of his schedule and my schedule, this is when we got him to give the dean's lecture. He's, I think anybody who watches TV knows him. Whenever there's a question about influenza or an outbreak, we see Andy on TV explaining in clear, precise language what the pathogenicity and the risk of various infections are. He's won lots of awards, and last year he got the Shikani Al-Hibri Prize for Discovery and Innovation. So please join me in congratulating and welcoming Andy Pekosz to the Dean's Lecture.
All right. Thanks, Mike, for that great introduction. And thank you all for coming here. We'll try to get out of here before the weather turns terrible today. So what I wanted to do today is give you three short stories that really sort of capture the essence of what my laboratory does. I'm going to start with a little bit of our work on live attenuated influenza vaccine, which really speaks to some of the work that we do on looking at the replication of influenza virus and the molecular mechanisms that are responsible for efficient virus replication. As Mike said, I've always had an interest in emerging viruses, and so we currently have a little project going on with an emerging virus called enterovirus D68, so I'll give you some of the work that we're doing there in terms of what we're interested in looking at in terms of assessing that virus's ability to cause disease. And then I'm going to end with some new work that has started about 3.5 years ago in collaboration with Rich Rothman over in emergency medicine and many others who are here in the room, where we've really started to look at human surveillance for influenza and ask what is going on with human influenza in the population, and are there any kinds of changes and things going on there that might help explain some of the seasonality of influenza and the varying disease severity that happens from year to year. And I'll show you at least one example of that tells us that the answer is yes, there's a lot going on in human flu circulating in the human population that we don't really study very well. So, you know, the main focus of my laboratory has always been on influenza and influenza disease. Influenza is made up of three distinct viruses, A, B, and C. The typical symptoms of influenza are fever, myalgia, malaise, and cough, usually with a very fast onset. And I've had three people email me today saying that they're sick with influenza. Two of them said they were diagnosed, so I believe them. But obviously, influenza-like illness is one of the most commonly used terms in the medical lexicon. So what we're really talking about is influenza caused by influenza A, B, or C virus infection. There are a number of parameters that tell us how important a disease it is. Anywhere between 10 to 20% of the human population in any given year is infected with influenza. The death toll in the United States ranges dramatically from 3,000 to 49,000 deaths annually. And a number of factors come into play here, including the strains that are circulating and whether or not the vaccines that we use are matched to those circulating strains. And in terms of productivity, over $7 billion in terms of a loss of productivity is one of the estimates that we get in terms of the outcomes or the economic effects of influenza infection. Again, as a basic research scientist, I have to give you a little bit of background on the virus. Influenza A virus, which is what we're focused on now because that's the one that we're most concerned about in terms of severe disease in the population and as a cause of pandemics. It's a member of the Orthomyxoviridae family. There are a couple of interesting things about the virus that help explain some of its properties. First and foremost is that it has a segmented genome, meaning that there are 8 distinct segments that encode anywhere from 1 to upwards of 3 or 4 proteins each of which that replicate as an autonomous element. Why is that important? Well, you'll be hearing me use the term segment reassortment as a means of generating diversity in influenza. So if 2 influenza viruses infect the same cell, these 8 genetic elements go in the cell, replicate independently of each other, and when viruses are forming, they can take combinations of these 8 segments from the 2 different viruses, generating a panel of viruses, some of whom are probably not very fit to circulate, but every once in a while we get something that has a new set of properties from both parental viruses, and those reassortant viruses are the ones that can cause enhanced disease in the population. It's also a negative sense RNA virus, which basically means that it has a very high mutation rate. And you'll see from some of our data that viruses change, if not on a weekly, if certainly on a monthly basis in terms of fixing mutations in viruses that circulate in humans. We're going to focus on 3 different proteins, all of whom form the outer surface of the virus particle. The HA protein, shown in this schematic in orange, is the protein that's responsible for binding to infected cells and for getting across the cellular membranes to initiate an infection. The NA, or neuraminidase protein, is shown here in blue. That protein has an important receptor-destroying activity which allows virus to escape from infected cells and infect the subsequent cells. And my favorite influenza protein, if I can say that, is a small integral membrane protein called M2, which I've been working on since I was a postdoc. We're continuously finding new things that this protein does, so it's certainly been a fruitful path. It's most known as an ion channel, has having an ion channel activity that's important during virus entry into cells, but we've also shown that it's important in virus assembly in terms of packaging and generating infectious virus particles. So in humans, influenza A virus is a pathogen of the respiratory tract, and we oftentimes think of our respiratory tract as being somewhat homogeneous. But I'm here to tell you that there actually are very, very distinct differences throughout your respiratory tract. And many of these are very critical to infection with viruses. First and foremost, your lining of your respiratory tract, the epithelium, is made up of very different cell types. And starting in the upper respiratory tract, in other words, your nose and your nasopharynx, you can have a change in the proportion of epithelial cells that are present as you move deeper into the lungs, through the trachea, into the bronchioles, down into the alveoli. So you can have different proportions of epithelial cells. In the upper respiratory tract, they're ciliated and goblet cells. Goblet cells make mucus. Ciliated cells beat and move mucus around. You have a third cell type called club cells, which come into play in the airways. And then once we get to the termini of the lung of the lung airways to the alveoli, we have other specialized types of epithelial cells. So the epithelial cells all are derived from common progenitors, but they differentiate into very specialized cells depending on where in the respiratory tract they're found. Another critical factor that's going to be a common theme in a lot of my work is temperature. The respiratory tract really represents a gradient of temperatures. In the lung, your lungs are basically at core body temperature of 37 degrees. But as you move up the respiratory tract, and in particular to the upper respiratory tract, the ambient temperature there is thought to be about an average of 32 degrees, which represents the mixing of core air coming out of your body at 37 and air being breathed in, which is room temperature. And that temperature difference is going to be, I'm going to show you, is a very important factor that helps limit virus replication. When it comes to influenza, the other factor that's important is the distribution of its cellular receptor, the molecule it binds to enter cells. Influenza binds a carbohydrate called sialic acid. Specifically, human influenza binds a form called alpha-2-6 sialic acid. Carbohydrate chemistry here is irrelevant, but what's important to know is that alpha-2-6 sialic acid is present primarily in the upper respiratory tract, and smaller amounts are present within the lungs. There's another form of sialic acid called 2-3 sialic acid. This is the sialic acid that's preferentially bound to by animal influenza virus, and this has almost an opposite expression pattern, whereas it's present deep in the lungs, but it's not present to any significant extent in the upper respiratory tract. And we're going to talk a little bit about how changing receptor tropism might affect influenza virus replication. So again, all those factors indicate that the respiratory tract is really a very heterogeneous environment when you're looking at the epithelial cells that make it up. Now, we're fortunate that we have influenza vaccines to provide at least some protection from influenza disease on an annual basis. Broadly speaking, influenza vaccines come in two categories. Inactivated or subunit vaccines, which consist of partially purified virus or viral proteins. These are administered via intramuscular or intradermal inoculation, and these are recommended for all individuals greater than 6 months of age. We have another influenza vaccine called live attenuated influenza vaccine, or LAIV. The trademark name for this is Flumist, made by the company MedImmune. This is a live attenuated infection, so it requires virus replication within the respiratory tract. It is attenuated in humans, meaning it replicates but doesn't cause disease. It's administered via nasal sprays directly into your respiratory tract. And this is recommended for individuals aged between the ages of 2 and 49. And for many years, it was thought that this was a good vaccine, particularly for children, because it generates a robust immune response, and it generates an immune response at the site of infection, and therefore you're optimizing the antiviral responses where the virus will actually see it. Unfortunately, for the past 2 years now, the LAIV is no longer recommended for use. And the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, which annually comes up with their recommendations for which vaccines, which age groups should take, noted that in light of very low effectiveness against one particular component of the LAIV vaccine, they could no longer recommend its use as a preventative measure. So we really lost one of the two arms of the immune response, and again, the one that was primarily working well for children and those young of age. So my lab had been working on LAIV for a while, so we wanted to ask some of the questions about perhaps, we still don't know for sure why this vaccine failure is occurring, but we thought we had some tools to put in place to actually address some of the LAIV replication and maybe get at some of the parameters that might be affecting vaccine efficacy. So flu vaccines are actually made taking advantage of this reassortment event that I was referring to before. We have master donor vaccine strains. We have one for making the inactivated flu, and we have one for making live attenuated flu. And we make our annual flu vaccines by surveying the human population, identifying the strains of flu that are the most dominant and that the ones that we think will come back in the following winter. And we reassort those circulating seasonal strains of flu with the master donor vaccine strain to generate a virus that has the surface proteins HA and NA from the seasonal circulating virus and all of the rest of the components from the master donor strain. In this way, we end up with a reassortant or chimeric virus that has the two proteins that are most important to generate a strong immune response that protects you from infection, but they're housed in the backbone of other genes which allow for efficient virus production and safety in humans. So LAIV has been around for a long time. It was initially generated in the late 60s and it really came to prominence in the 80s and 90s as a influenza vaccine. The virus really has three properties. It is cold adapted, meaning that it has been adapted to grow at colder and colder temperatures so that it can efficiently replicate at temperatures as low as 25 or 29 degrees. It is also temperature sensitive, meaning that it's unable to replicate at higher temperatures, and 39 degrees is usually the temperature that people study the temperature sensitivity of LAIV. And most importantly, it is attenuated, meaning that if you put it in an animal model of disease or if you administer it to a human, you won't get the disease that's associated with virus infection. And for many years, it was thought that the most important aspect here are these temperature-sensitive and cold-adapted phenotypes, which map to three proteins that are involved in the viral polymerase, the genome replication complex of the virus. Now, it was important to note that there are five other amino acid changes which were initially ruled out as contributing to this attenuation of LAIV. And it's also important to note that the studies that identified those mutations were done in very particular ways. They used a cell line called MDCK cells, which are a canine kidney cell line, which influenza virologists use frequently because it's a very hardy cell line and grows virus very well. Or we use embryonated hen's eggs, which is another way of growing the virus that's critical for vaccine production. You'll note that neither one of these resemble respiratory epithelial cells in the least. And I think another drawback of some of the studies was that they oftentimes used a non-physiological range of temperatures, meaning they took the extreme temperatures, 29 degrees for cold sensitivity, 39 degrees for temperature sensitivity, and studied virus replication at those extremes, which as an experimental approach is perfectly valid. All of us want to have our extremes in terms of understanding our phenotypes that's easiest to study. But when one puts this back in the concept of trying to understand how a vaccine is working, one has to think about these other more physiological parameters in terms of assessing virus replication. So when I moved here from WashU, we were fortunate enough to set up a collaboration with Andrew Lane, who's in the otolaryngology department at the School of Medicine, who can routinely obtain nasal samples from both diseased as well as non-diseased patients. And we worked with him to set up a human nasal epithelial cell, or HNEC, culture system, which involves us taking scrapings from individuals, expanding them in our laboratories in regular tissue culture dishes, plating them onto these transwell dishes, which consist of a semi-porous membrane sitting inside a tissue culture dish, And when we plate the cells here, we bathe them in a proliferation media to get them to grow up to very high numbers. We then stimulate these cells to differentiate into what looks like the nasal epithelium by removing the apical media from inside this well and changing the basolateral media to a more low nutrient-containing media. And those two stimuli cause the cells to go from rather nondescript cells to the specialized cells that are present within the respiratory tract. And I'm showing you here a scanning EM of cells 3 days post what we call ALI, or air-liquid interface, versus 14 days post ALI. You can see that the cells go from a rather nondescript form to now this heterogeneous epithelial cell culture. These cells here have cilia projections. These cilia will beat when you look at them in vitro. The other cells in here, here's a cell that's just beginning to develop its cilia. And the other cells in the culture represent cell types that are also found in the respiratory tract, specifically the cells that make the mucus. So these cells will actually make mucus, and even though we remove the media from them over the course of several days, they acquire a liquid layer on top of them. So this really represents what we think influenza and LAIV, in this case, really sees in terms of a cell type and the barriers that the virus has to overcome in order to initiate an infection. And therefore, we think this is a great model system for use in studying the virus. Okay, so when we first started to work with this, a clinical fellow in my laboratory, William Fisher, designed a relatively simple experiment. If everything I told you was true, when we used a physiologically relevant cell type using physiologically important ranges of temperature, we should be able to assess whether LAIV, what LAIV replication really looks like in this model system. So we did an experiment where we took wild-type influenza and an LAIV that has the HA and NA protein from that wild-type influenza. And we infected our MDCK cells at either 32 degrees, which is the permissive temperature. And you can see that both viruses replicate to almost equivalent titers here. We've got infectious virus on the y-axis and time on the x-axis. At 37 degrees, again, this physiological range of temperatures, you start to see that the LAIV is replicating less efficiently, while the wild-type virus is replicating more efficiently. So now you're starting to see the attenuation that we study with LAIV. Now, if we repeat this experiment, but this time only substituting for the MDCK cells our human nasal epithelial cells, we see a very different result. Even at 32 degrees, the quote-unquote permissive temperature for LAIV, you're starting to see LAIV replicating less efficiently than the wild-type influenza. It's replicating with much slower kinetics, eventually reaching close to the peak titers, but again, it takes literally 3 or 4 days longer for this virus to replicate to those titer levels. And when we repeat this experiment at 37, those differences are even more amplified. Again, a combination of wild-type flu growing better and LAIV growing worse. So this tells us that within that physiological range of temperature, we're seeing an attenuation for LAIV, but it's also telling us that there's something going on about epithelial cells themselves that making them a little bit more refractory for LAIV replication. And this is something that hadn't been picked up over the years of studying LAIV simply because the more relevant cell culture system hadn't been used. So we decided to further study that, and we tried to make the next obvious connection, which is, well, if there's less virus, there's probably, if less infectious virus, there's probably less virus particles. Let's study those virus particles. And here's where we found our first sort of interesting left turn in our research. So we isolated virus particles from our nasal epithelial cells, and you can see here the infectious virus titers. This is a log scale, so there's a tenfold difference at 33 degrees and a hundredfold difference at 37 degrees in infectious virus particles. But when we then looked to see how many total particles were there, we were fully expecting to see a small amount of particles. But here is an assay called a hemagglutination assay, which just judges particles irrespective of their infectivity. And you can see that the wild type and the LAIV have an endpoint that's exactly the same. So even though their infectious virus titers differ by 100-fold, the total number of particles present appears to be about the same. So this told us that it wasn't a lack of production of virus particles that was different. The cells were still making an awful lot of virus particles. It's just that the infectivity of those particles was reduced dramatically. Therefore, we were making more non-infectious virus particles as opposed to infectious virus particles. And that was an interesting story because it smelled very much like a line of research that we had been working on for many, many years, studying the influenza virus M2 protein. And then specifically in the influenza M2 protein, there are sequences that control this infectious virus particle production. And so I looked back at some of the old studies of LEIV, and sure enough, in the when I looked at the sequences of LEIV, there is one mutation in the influenza M2 protein that was generated during the egg passaging and adaption of LEIV to colder temperatures. And it appeared at position 86 of that cytoplasmic tail of M2. And if you look in the database, wild-type influenza viruses have either an alanine or valine at that position. There's only one virus in the database that has anything other than that, and it's LEIV. This mutation had been studied in MDCK cells and eggs, but as I told you before, some of these phenotypes that we're seeing only penetrate in epithelial cell cultures. So we made the next leap and said, well, maybe we should investigate this mutation specifically for its effects on M2 and epithelial cells. But as I told you before, we've been studying the cytoplasmic tail of M2 for literally 7 or 8 years, and we had basically mutagenized the entire cytoplasmic tail of influenza, changing the endogenous amino acids to alanines to look for functional domains. What we had forgotten to do is to look for the alanines that are present in those and change them to something different. And if you notice, that's exactly where this M2 LEIV mutation occurs. It changes a naturally occurring alanine residue to a serine. And that is at a position 86, which we had previously identified as being one of the regions that are important for viral genome packaging and making sure that the particles that are being made are infectious virus particles. So basically, this is, we put two and two together and did the experiment that we wanted to do, which is to take our LEIV. We made an infectious clone system so we could manipulate every nucleotide in the viral genome. And we made two viruses which were absolutely identical, except for the amino acid encoded at position 86 of the M2 protein. And we again did our standard temperature experiment where we generated these viruses, the wild-type LEIV, and a virus that contains the alanine position that's found in seasonal influenza viruses. In MDCK cells at 32, both viruses replicated to the same kinetics. Same was true at 37 degrees in MDCK cells. Perhaps slightly surprising, at 32 degrees in nasal epithelial cells, the viruses also replicated about the same. But when we did the infection at 37 degrees in our human nasal epithelial cell cultures, the virus that had the alanine present in circulating strains of flu replicated to 10 to 100-fold higher levels than the LEIV virus, suggesting that in contrast to the literature, this M2 amino acid change must be contributing to the attenuation of LEIV, but it's contributing only in an epithelial cell-specific matter. We don't see this phenotype on other standard cell types. So we identified at least one new mutation in LEIV that previously wasn't appreciated in terms of its ability to lower the replication of LEIV. Now, there's another little secret about growing influenza vaccines, and that's the vast majority of the influenza vaccine that we use is grown in embryonated hen's eggs. And it's incredibly important for the yield of virus coming out of an egg to be as high as possible because, on average, one infected egg yields about 3 to 4 doses of influenza vaccine. Our current flu vaccine consists of 4 different viruses, so you can do the math. To get a 4-component influenza vaccine and to have hundreds of millions of doses, you need an awful lot of eggs. So even differences as low as 3-fold in terms of yield from eggs can dramatically impact vaccine production. So when we pick strains of flu to include in their vaccine, we do that around the end of February or so, which is kind of odd because, as I just mentioned, we're still actually seeing influenza cases now towards the middle of March. But we have to make that choice towards the end of February because the vaccine production pipeline is rigidly linked to having at least a 6-month window of time between when the vaccine choice is made and when you want to administer the first vaccines to the general population. And virtually all of that timeline is spent on growing virus in embryonated eggs. So vaccine choices are made in February. There's a small window in March where these vaccines are adapted for growth in embryonated eggs. And then once a suitable vaccine strain is identified, it's distributed to all the vaccine companies so they can type in their pipeline. this step of adapting virus to eggs is one that actually has turned out to be a very critical one for vaccine efficacy. When influenza virus adapts to eggs, it actually results in a couple of changes in the surface protein HA, which is the protein that we want to generate an antibody response to. Here's just an example. This is an X-ray crystal structure of HA, and in this one particular year, there were 5 amino acid changes that occurred in this protein between the time it was chosen as a vaccine strain versus the time the vaccine stock was ready to be distributed to companies. In the past, these amino acid changes have been shown to alter the antigenic structure. So the antibodies that are generated to it can be slightly different from what's seen in seasonal flu. Another thing that happens is that these viruses oftentimes adapt to utilize the avian receptor, which is a 2,3 sialic acid, which, as I've told you before, is not present in the upper respiratory tract of humans to as great an extent. So besides the identification of amino acid changes that might be attenuating influenza, LAIV, outside of the temperature sensitivity, we wanted to ask the question of what is the role of some of these egg-adapted mutations in terms of LAIV replication? So Harry Powell, a grad student in my lab, has taken up this challenge, and he's generated, using our infectious clone system, influenza viruses in an LAIV background that have HA proteins that correspond to the egg-adapted form, as well as the starting material, what I call the wild-type seasonal flu. And we've used those viruses and asked how they replicate on human nasal epithelial cell questions. So again, the experiment is the same as we've done before. We inoculate at either 32 degrees or 37 degrees, and we look for infectious virus production over time. And what you can see here is that at 32 degrees, the egg-adapted HA replicates less efficiently than the virus that has the wild-type influenza, at least in our human nasal epithelial cell culture systems. Now, here's where our trade-off comes in. This is in human nasal epithelial cells, but in eggs, these viruses do the opposite. The egg-adapted virus grows to a higher yield than the wild-type virus. So if you're looking at this from a vaccine production standpoint, the egg-adapted mutation is perfect. But what we're showing you here is that these egg adaptions may also be contributing to less effective replication of LAIV, which may also then be driving this issue of less effective vaccine efficacy with this virus, because if you don't get enough virus replication, you may not get a strong enough immune response to induce those protective responses. And this phenotype is seen even stronger at 37, where now you can see a very transient replication of the egg-adapted virus in these cultures, whereas the wild-type virus does replicate to slightly longer periods of time with LAIV. Again, less efficiently at 37 than at 33 because LAIV is attenuated. But certainly this is telling us that these egg-adapted mutations can have deleterious effects on LAIV replication in its target tissue, the upper respiratory tract. And that's an as yet unappreciated aspect that might be contributing to reduced vaccine efficacy. All right, so I've told you a lot about some of these basic research studies that we do looking at how infectious virus particles are made, how effectively viruses replicate in cells. And I've told you these stories on the background of the LAIV. So LAIV, we've shown, is attenuated at quote-unquote permissive temperatures when you use the appropriate cell culture system, human nasal epithelial cells. And we've also identified another, an as yet unidentified mutation in the M2 protein, which alters LAIV replication in nasal epithelial cells, but not in MDCK cultures. So one of the things that we want to do further is we want to go after those other 4 amino acid changes and see if any of them are also contributing to LAIV replication in HNEX. And I think our end goal here is we really may be able to represent a real sort of sea change in terms of how we look at LAIV. Previous to our work, LAIV was viewed as an on-off switch. It had a temperature sensitivity that was either there or not. What we're showing is that there may be other mutations that are contributing to that attenuation. So now instead of an on-off switch, maybe we have a dimmer. Maybe we can introduce multiple mutations to either increase the replication of this virus or decrease it, depending on which population we want to go into. Because as I mentioned at the beginning, right now it's only allowed to be used between the ages of 2 and 49. So a more attenuated virus might be able to get us into the 0 to 2 population. A more robustly replicating LAIV may get us into that elderly population. And those two populations are really the populations that suffer the most from influenza in our year. All right, so let me switch gears a little bit to our the second story that I want to talk about, and that's a virus called enterovirus D68. Enterovirus D68 was first identified in 1962, but it really only became on people's radar screens until the early 2000s, when the number of cases of enterovirus D68 infection in humans really sort of spiked in the late 2000s. This came to a culminate in 2014, where there was a massive epidemic of severe respiratory disease, particularly in pediatric populations across the US and many other countries in the world. Previous to that, EVD68 was put into the category of common cold-leg viruses. It caused an upper respiratory tract infection, got you sick for a couple days, but was really nothing that you couldn't live with. It was really in 2014 that this idea of lower respiratory tract infections, particularly in pediatric populations, became a dominant phenotype associated with infection. And even more concerningly, a small percentage of the children infected with EVD68 got a disease called acute flaccid myelitis, or AFM, which is a polio-like paralysis disease of your limbs. So both of these brought up a sort of increased interest in what was going on with EVD68 in terms of it being why has it changed so significantly and had resorted to causing so much more disease in the population. So we took what we learned with our LAIV studies and our primary epithelial cells and asked whether temperature sensitivity could be a parameter that had changed in EVD68 that was perhaps mediating more of this disease. And again, we've got replication at 32 degrees versus 37 degrees across the respiratory tract. It had been well documented that EVD68 is attenuated at 37 degrees in studies from the 80s and 90s. So we asked, given what we learned about LAIV, whether or not temperature might be a different factor now affecting the more modern strains of influenza of EVD68. And that this ability to overcome the temperature barrier might allow this virus to not only penetrate deeper in the lungs, but perhaps leave the respiratory tract and penetrate into the central nervous system tissues. So Brendan Smith, a graduate student in my lab, did some simple experiments where he took historical strains of EVD68 and one example of a modern strain of EVD68. In this case, he did a plaque assay, which allows us to look for infectious centers on cells. He did it at 32 and 37 degrees. And surprisingly, the older strains of EVD68 could not form plaques at 37, whereas a newer strain from isolated in Missouri 2014 was able to form plaques at 37 degrees. So this was our first hint that maybe this virus had acquired the ability to replicate at higher temperatures in more recent isolates. We then did infections on our nasal epithelial cell cultures at both 32 and 37 degrees. And what we've shown here is our 1963 strain here and our 2014 strain here. The 2014 strain grows to higher titers than the 1963 strain at 32 degrees, so it's better able to replicate in epithelial cells. And at 37 degrees, the virus is still somewhat attenuated, but you can see that at 37, the new strain of EVD68 grows much more efficiently and for a longer period of time than the older strain of EVD68, suggesting that temperature sensitivity may be one factor that has changed with this virus that has allowed us that has allowed it to perhaps now present with different types of disease in the human population. So we think that these recent isolates now cause lower respiratory disease and can leave the respiratory tract and infect central nervous system tissue may be linked to this phenomenon of being able to replicate at 37 degrees, as well as to be able to replicate more efficiently in human respiratory epithelial cells. And just 2 weeks ago, a model system had been studied showing that in a mouse, EVD68 infection of the central nervous system can actually cause acute flaccid myelitis. And so this is direct, and this can only be done with more recent isolates of virus. The older isolates are unable to cause this disease in the mouse model of infection, which we take as supporting evidence suggesting that overcoming a temperature barrier may be part of what has happened to this virus to make it a more severe human pathogen. And we're now going down the pathway of understanding what changes in the virus genome are controlling this replication and how this might affect EVD replication in epithelial cells and in disease model systems. Okay, so then the last thing that I want to talk about is our work through the Johns Hopkins Center of Excellence in Influenza Research and Surveillance, or JHCRS, which, as I mentioned briefly, is directed by Rich Rothman and myself. And we're really tasked to improve the ability of both the medical and public health infrastructure to respond to seasonal and pandemic influenza. And we do this by creating a pipeline where we've got clinicians working with infected individuals to identify virus samples, serum samples, and to capture clinical information from people infected with influenza and move that information into basic research pathways to then better inform our public health and medical responses to epidemic influenza. We do this through human surveillance efforts at two sites. One is located here at Johns Hopkins University, and another is located at Changgung Memorial Hospital, which is in Taipei, Taiwan. So we have two rather largely distinct geographic sites from which we can surveil for influenza. So we've been doing this for 3 years. In each of the 3 years, we found something interesting in terms of seasonal influenza. So I'm just going to briefly touch on our first set of experiments that focused on the 2014-15 influenza season and what we found in a set of samples from our Johns Hopkins network. In 2014-15, the influenza season was a rather severe season. It was characterized by an antigenic drift variant of H3N2. So the circulating strain of H3N2 was different from the vaccine strain. The vaccine didn't induce protective immunity, and therefore more of us were susceptible to infection with the H3N2 influenza virus. And of course, this resulted in a global increase in influenza activity throughout that winter season. So we were able to access passive surveillance samples from individuals who were influenza A positive from the Johns Hopkins Medical Network. The viruses from the clinical samples were then put through our pipeline of diagnostics, sequencing, and phylogenetics, and then moved into the virus characterization pipeline. And this is sort of our first test of our network, with diagnostics being run by Charlotte Gatos and sequencing and phylogenetics by Peter Thielen, who's at Applied Physics Laboratory. And of course, our laboratory had the infectious clone technologies and the epithelial cell culture systems to study the virus characterization. So what happened that year? If we look at it as a normal influenza season does, we can look at the HA sequences and say that in our population, the virus that was circulating turned out to be a virus called 3C2A, which was the antigenic drift variant. So it's as simple as that. Most of the viruses isolated through the Johns Hopkins system were the drift variant that was immune to the vaccine-induced protective pressures, and therefore this was the dominant virus causing disease. If we used a set of samples from Wright-Patterson Air Force Base that was acquired earlier in the flu season, we saw a little bit more diversity. There was less of the antigenic drift variant and more of the other strains of flu circulating. So over the course of that flu season, we went from a heterogeneous population of viruses to basically infection with just the antigenic drift variant. And if you look at the national sequence data for H3N2 viruses over a 3-year period, in 2013-14, the drift variant was a minor component of viruses sequenced. In 2014-15, it became the major component. And in the following year, it continued to be the major virus circulating in the human population. So, this all fits dogma in the standard sort of vaccine-mediated proof, but we had a large number of viral sequences where we had not only the HA sequence, but also the sequence of all the other viral genes. And so several people in my laboratory, led by Dina Blumenkrantz, started to look at some of these other sequences, and they noticed that there were some interesting changes in some other genes. So all the viruses that were the antigenic drift variant were obviously had a lot of similarities there. But a large percentage of the viruses that we isolated had a change in the neuraminidase, or NA protein, which introduced a position at 245, which resulted in the addition of a carbohydrate residue onto the NA molecule. In those same isolates, we found a mutation in a protein called PB1F2, which had previously been implicated as being important in initiating the antiviral immune responses to infection. And it was at a position that was already previously characterized as being important for that protein's function. So by looking deeper, we saw that there were at least two other changes that were present in the population that coincided with this movement of antigenic drift vaccines through the population. So what we did through work with Peter Thielen and Tom Mihok at APL is we did a phylogenetic tree to understand the relationships between various viruses. And there's a lot on this slide, but it really is simple to interpret. The viruses that both of these mutations, the NA-gly positive and the F2P, all are genetically linked. Whether you look at our Hopkins sample right here, or the general population of viruses sequenced from the US right here, all of them are highly related to each other. And if these mutations were to spring up independently of each other or randomly, we would expect these to be scattered throughout the phylogenetic tree, but we don't see those, implying that when these mutations occurred, they occurred very close to each other, and that those viruses quickly had some sort of a replication advantage and were able to propagate in the population at the expense of one of the parental viruses. Now this is, again, these two viruses are both antigenic drift vaccines, so we're not just talking about escape from vaccine, we're talking about another change in the virus's properties that may be important for its persistence in the population. If we now look at the virus sequences with that genotype in mind, what we see is in our Hopkins sample, now in this aqua color is the virus that has those two mutations. In the purplish color is the virus with the two mutations. In our Hopkins samples, this virus seemed to be a minority of samples during this year. Our Wright-Patterson Air Force samples, which were collected early in the year, had none of those viruses with these two new genotypes. But if we now look at the sequences in the human population, this genotype went from not being present in 2013-14 to being about 18% of the sequences in 2014-15 to being nearly 70% of the sequences present in the following year. Now, this virus and this virus here are both able to escape vaccines equivalently. So what this implies to us is that this particular genotype, driven by these two other changes, was providing some sort of fitness advantage to this virus, which allowed it to outcompete another virus that looked almost exactly like the same as it. What was also interesting is when we looked at the clinical data and we split the patients up between patients that were infected without these two mutations versus people infected with viruses that contain these two mutations. And for at least two phenotypes, shortness of breath and wheezing, more patients infected with the double mutant virus complained of shortness of breath and wheezing than compared to the other than patients infected with the other genotype virus, suggesting that perhaps there was a phenotypic change in the disease state that's associated with infection with this particular substrain of virus. So to study that virus, we needed to isolate it. The first thing we did is we used our nasal epithelial cell culture systems to try to get isolates from the human population. We compared them to our standard way of generating cultures using these MDCK cells, and we found that we were much more efficient at recovering virus from nasal samples using our nasal epithelial cell culture system than we were using MDCK cells. Nearly three times more likely to get a virus from our nasal cell cultures compared to standard cell cultures. And this was true irrespective of what group the virus was coming from. So we again pulled a few people in the laboratory together. Dina and Harry Powell being the primary people, and we started to characterize these viruses. We have a virus here that lacks the two mutations, and one that does have the two mutations. On our MDCK cells and some other cell types, these viruses replicated to equivalent titers. In our nasal cells, we see a very small but significant difference in titer, with the virus that has the two mutations replicating a little less efficiently than the other virus. But at the end, they both reach the same peak titers. And if we look at the ability of these viruses to kill cells and form plaques, they both seem to form viruses at about the same rate. So there were some interesting results here, but certainly nothing compelling to tell us that there's a major change in how this virus is replicating. Now, one of the things that we know that these glycosylation sites do is they oftentimes tend to mask antibody epitopes, or they affect the virus's ability to interact with carbohydrate receptors. And I'm showing you here the three-dimensional structure of the NA. This is the receptor-destroying site, and this is the new glycosylation site that's present here. So it's right here, right next to where the receptor-destroying site is. So one might hypothesize that this glycosylation site could interfere with the protein's ability to destroy receptors. And so Harry performed a receptor-destroying activity, And we found that the virus that did not have the glycosylation had a very strong receptor-destroying activity, but the presence of that glycosylation site resulted in at least a fourfold reduction in the enzymatic activity of this protein. Now, that was a little bit odd to us because a reduction in this kind of enzymatic activity doesn't seem to be a fitness advantage. But our working hypothesis now is that this glycosylation site may also be masking an antibody binding site, which is neutralizing the virus. And so to these two viruses, escaping neutralization from antibodies at the expense of losing some enzymatic activity may be a fitness payoff that allows it to have an advantage in the human population. And so we're going after the structure of these to see if this glycosylation site in some way interferes with antibodies binding to NA to sort of test that hypothesis. So I've shown you one example of how things going on in human influenza are much more complicated than just does the virus match the vaccine or does it not. And we've been fortunate enough to see these types of changes in our samples over the next 2 years of our surveillance efforts. So we're really looking to understand how these two mutations here are affecting virus replication and characterize these mutations separately in terms of assessing how they might be affecting viral fitness and contributing to virus circulation. So I hope I've shown you at least three examples of how approaches focused on basic research, but applying basic research to relevant human pathogens has provided us with a wealth of information about things that we really had no understanding of before we started some of these lines of research. And we hope that, and again, we have a laboratory full of people that are doing similar types of projects with other viruses and are constantly amazed at how much interesting variation we're seeing with human influenza viruses and emerging infectious viruses. All right, so let me just take a few seconds because, as Mike mentioned, you only get promoted to full professor once in your lifetime, hopefully. And this was a great time for me to sort of think back at who the people who have been really important in terms of my scientific career development. And I think it all starts back to training and opportunities. And so the mentors that I've had since my undergraduate days, Aaron Shatkin at Rutgers University, Francisco Anil at UPenn, and my postdoc advisor, Robert Lamb, were all fantastic mentors who really challenged me and allowed me some freedom to do my work. Training is nothing unless you're given the opportunity to apply that training. And that's where Steve Beverly, who first hired me at WashU, and Diane Griffin, who recruited me here, and Arturo Castadal, the current chair, have been really fantastic in terms of providing me with even more opportunities to take our work and really apply it in new ways and to do new and innovative things until we get our preliminary data together so we can submit an NIH grant and get all of the checks out of the way that way. So those environments have really been fantastic in terms of allowing me to move our research forward into new and general areas. If anybody's been in my office, you've seen that I have this hanging on my wall. This was a gift from Neil Nathanson to me when he first retired. No, I wasn't being a psychic and predicting that I was going to eventually get a job at Johns Hopkins University. It's the first half of this statement that really resonates with me, and that's Ira Remsen's statement that every man does his best work when he's allowed to do it in his own way. We can make that more politically correct these days, of course, but I think the principle here is what really has driven me in terms of my scientific career. I've had the fortune to have mentors and opportunities presented to me, and then given the freedom to take advantage of those and move those in the best way that I see fit. And for that, I'll be eternally grateful. Besides that, you know, this was a great time to look back at some of the people who have gone through my laboratory. And this may look like movie credits font, but it's important that, I spent a few days looking back at these people, catching up with them, and it was fantastic for me to know that everybody who's on this list is trained in my laboratory is still involved in science or medicine in some way. I think most importantly, the group over here, Celeste, Sean, Wei Hong, and Michael, were people who moved with me from WashU, and they were intimately responsible in setting up our laboratory and getting it moving here as fast as possible. And of course, the whole crew over here, which is now involved in all of our SEER studies, I think we're challenging them on an almost weekly basis in terms of new things that we're finding out in terms of our viruses, new ways to analyze data, and so we're keeping them on their toes, but hopefully in a good way. And I think finally, collaborations are one of the things that are fantastic, and I've been very, very fortunate to be involved with so many fantastic scientists. All of our collaborations, whether they be brief ones, whether they be long ones, whether they resulted in publications or not, I've looked back and I've really taken a lot from all of them. Like I said, some of the people on this list, we may have never published together. Others, for instance, our work with Sauber Klein, for instance, is an ongoing, very productive line of looking at the effect of biological sex and sex hormones on epithelial cell functions. And, of course, our new Jade Sears people forming this pipeline of clinicians, sequencers, virologists, and having us all work together effectively has been a wonderful challenge to take on. And I think it's brought along a lot of benefits as well in terms of our understanding of influenza. And, of course, funding agencies, the work wouldn't be responsible. So with that, I will end, and thank you for all your attention, and I'll be happy to take any questions you might have.
Well, that was a great talk, and I'm sure there's going to be lots of questions. Let me just ask a couple. So I saw the data, on M2 and the mutation M2, maybe explaining the decreased efficacy of the live attenuated. But do you have any data on samples over time, from earlier flu mists? Has that mutation increased in prevalence?
So that mutation appears to have been fixed and is always present in every batch of LAIV that's been coming through, as much as we know. There hasn't been a lot of sequencing of these viruses up until maybe the last 5 to 10 years. But when we've been able to find older isolates and sequence them ourselves, we found that mutation to be present in all the batches of LAIV that we can at least get our hand on. So we think it's a common factor through all the LAIVs that are there.
So that wouldn't explain that there's more recently decreased efficacy.
And I think that's where the egg adaption part might be coming in. There's the flu vaccine, the H1N1 component that's present in that. There were two different versions that were tried, both of which have an egg-adapted form that has mutations close to the receptor binding site. And so we're right now putting those viruses into our infectious clone system to directly ask whether or not the egg-adapted mutations in the H1s are affecting virus replication in nasal epithelial cells, which will be the more direct proof of whether or not that's contributing to the recent failure of LAIV.
So when you first came, there was a lot of talk, we were worried about the pandemic, and there was a lot of talk about it. One, a universal vaccine, and
right.
Two, getting away from growing an egg. And so I was just wondering where those two things fit now. So are we any closer to a universal vaccine? Are we developing systems other than growing viruses and eggs?
So there's been tremendous progress in terms of a universal vaccine. Since the time I was recruited here, at least two other important immunogens that generate very broadly reactive antibodies have been identified. Mm-hmm. And so that combined...
Other than H&N?
Well, they target very specific areas of HA called the stalk region, which seems to be much more conserved across virus strains than the head region where I showed you some of these mutations occur. So those stalk antibodies appear to be quite effective at generating broad-based immune responses. And then in combination with M2-based vaccines, and people are making even more progress on cellular immune responses that are broad, mm-hmm. I think the universal vaccine approach is there are multiple arms that are now showing some level of feasibility in terms of moving into the population. Mm-hmm. The egg-based vaccines have gone virtually nowhere. Mm-hmm. We're still stuck with the production facilities that we have. The capital investment to close all those down and retool for some other means of growing flu vaccines has always been taught to be too big of a burden for the vaccine manufacturers to really invest in or want to overcome. So we are still tied to egg-based flu production.
Great. So any other questions or comments? Yeah. You got to step up to the mic because we're recording this.
Great talk. Pushing that a little bit further, someone who doesn't want the flu.
Right.
Some of the stuff that you're saying is, I like the idea of innovation, and people are receptive, I'm understanding this. Hey, we got to go beyond just the basic function there. If you were to speculate on how we would go forward, What is the future? I mean, are we going to sit in 10 years, 15 years from now, as you're wrapping it up and you're now dean or whatever in there and you're giving a talk? What can we do besides this egg thing? Because that seems crazy to me
as a
way to go. Or are we just stuck because there's no money in it beyond there? Or is there a way we can really push this forward?
Yeah. So even some of these universal HA stock means of generating vaccines are still now being funneled into the egg production pipeline. So I think that we can eliminate all the problems associated with egg production if we simply switch to more cell culture-based vaccines. So that, to me, is the largest hurdle. That is not a scientific problem. That is an economics problem. That's a capital problem. And so that requires a whole other group of people to get involved in the decision-making process. But really, as simple as substituting even something like these MDCK cells or modified versions of those cells could get us away from these mutations if we had the capital to retool all the vaccine manufacturing companies away from eggs.
Could you do a homebrew?
We can do it all the time.
Homebrew vaccine system that we could do and franchise the pocket? I'm just curious. Is this one of the ways to think on that?
Only enough to immunize lab members and keep them working in the event of a pandemic, though. So
I just put that by homebrew, he meant GMP facility, right?
Oh, yeah.
Any other comments or questions? Do you have a question?
Thanks very much. And some context before I ask my question, which may give you a little too much idea about the question. I'm now working on carbohydrate structures. So you said that the alpha-2-6 is the one that we have for the infection of the influenza that we're affected by. But we know there have been worries about the cross for the avian flu and so on and so forth that presumably use the alpha-2-3. Sialic acid, is anyone working on the structural differences between them to try and help us better understand how that from bird to mammal can occur?
Yes, absolutely. And I think it's an incredibly competitive area of research. All human strains of flu have to recognize alpha-2-6 to spread effectively. And that's probably because we either need to replicate in the upper respiratory tract to a certain level to get transmission to occur, mm-hmm. or the cells that are best at producing the virus that transmits have a higher amount of alpha-2-6 sialic acid. And there's now lines of research suggesting both of those are probably true. Now, the barrier to avian species probably comes at that aspect of it. And a great example is, currently we're in the middle of an H7N9 outbreak, where there are a number of people, almost 4,000, I believe, this year, that have been infected with this avian virus, which causes very severe disease, but doesn't transmit among humans. And that virus causes severe disease because it penetrates deeper into the lung and causes lung damage at a much faster rate than seasonal flu does. But again, because it's not as present in the upper respiratory tract, you don't get the transmission from person to person. So there's a lot of work that's been done trying to understand that. There's a lot of threat preparedness work that's being done saying what mutations can confer the ability to recognize 2,6 sialic acid onto some of these influenza viruses. That line of research is a little bit problematic because one can always argue that you're making new human pathogens from ones that aren't human pathogens. And so there are a lot of biosafety concerns and ethical concerns that come into that research, which has slowed it down a little bit. But certainly there's a lot of work going on to understanding how easy or how difficult it is for avian viruses to make these switches.
Now, are any known to recognize both?
Yes. Yes. And as a carbohydrate chemist, you'll also appreciate the fact that I've simplified it to 2,6 sialic acid. Other saccharides play a role in this as well, too, so it's not as simple as a yes-no bind to one or the other. There are lots of things that flu does in terms of recognizing these carbohydrates that factor into its efficiently recognizing cells.
Thank you.
I've got a mic. So what's driving the evolution of D68 towards pathogenicity?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I don't know what that is. EVD68 is an odd virus. It tends to peak in terms of its in the fall, so before, let's say, flu season. It penetrates oftentimes every other year, so it's not an annual epidemic. And in particular, it's really been targeting children most recently. So it may be a combination of this temperature sensitivity allowing it to be more effective at infecting children and therefore propagating more effectively, and a byproduct of it is that it can cause more severe disease at times too.
Are the nucleotide sequence changes known?
There are a lot of sequence strains. Many of them are strains that were isolated on cells and have acquired other mutations, so there really is an effort now to do what we're doing, for instance, in our flu network, which is to not think about the cells until you know what the sequences of the clinical samples are, and then start from those sequences in terms of analyzing virus properties. There have been a lot of changes, a lot of evolution of this virus that went on over the past 10 years, and so a lot of amino acids to sort through in terms of looking for functional ones that are contributing to this temperature sensitivity.
Right. So maybe I'll ask the last question. Do I have two questions? So, why is it called enterovirus if it's a respiratory pathogen? And what's the mechanism of the acute flaccid myelitis, do we know?
So the first question is the easy one. It is genetically related to enteroviruses. It was initially thought to be, based on small sequence data, to be more closely related to enteroviruses. As we got more, a greater understanding of its biology and more sequence diversity, we realize that it's a virus that is in the enterovirus family, but it now behaves much more like a rhinovirus, a virus that causes the common cold. So rarely does it infect the intestinal tract, and more commonly it now infects the upper respiratory tract. But because it's genetically more closely related to enteroviruses, it stayed in that category. The mechanism behind acute flaccid myelitis is still a big question mark. It's been very, very difficult to do all the accurate epidemiology linking the infection to the AFM, because the respiratory infection oftentimes can happen 2 weeks before the presentation of central nervous system disease. Mm-hmm. Spinal fluid from AFM patients sometimes has the virus, sometimes doesn't. So there's been a lot of difficulty in terms of connecting all of our dots in terms of the genetics there. But this new mouse model suggests that the virus, if it gets into the central nervous system, it can induce a polio-like disease just by replicating in nerve cells in the spinal cord. So right now, that's the working hypothesis, is that somehow this virus leaves the respiratory tract, gets into the central nervous system in a small number of cases, and can cause the AFM by directly infecting those cells. But that's the working hypothesis.
Great. Well, let's join me in thanking Andy again for a great talk and all you contributed to our school.
Thank you.